today, Brian Dirksen.
Amen, amen. Good morning, church. It's good to see you all here this morning. We want to say welcome. For those that don't know me, I'm Jeff DeYoung. I'm the pastor here at Hillsborough Baptist Church, and we're glad to have you with us. We would love to have a record of your visit. If you fill out one of our connection cards in the seat pockets in front of you, you can put those in the offering plate or on the boxes on the back wall of the church. And we also use those for prayer requests or praise items, that if you have a prayer request, you can fill those out and we'll pass those along to our prayer team, or to you can also put on, as I say, praise items, which we love to hear when God has answered prayer. And I want to encourage you folks, if God has answered your prayers, write those down, share them with the team, share them with the church. We want to be able to celebrate what God is doing. I want to make you aware of a few things coming up. First off, this coming Friday, there's a wedding shower for Aaron Jackman and Marcus Brueger. That's at 7 p.m. at Elaine Jackman's, which is on 40 Carey Street. That should be in your bulletins, I believe. And so you're invited to come and show your support to Aaron and Marcus. We also have coming up Backpack Giveaway Sunday. You can see the display here up on the stage. Sunday, August 18th, 2 weeks, we're going to be inviting families from the community that need help with getting their kids back to school. And so there's a sign-up sheet in the foyer with various items that are needed. We also need, we're going to be supporting the families as well. It's a $35 cost per student just to register their students. And so if you can help contribute to that, we'd really appreciate it. We've got about 20 kids signed up already for school fees, so that means we need to raise about $1,000 to help with covering all the different expenses. That same day, we're going to have a fellowship gathering after the morning worship service, so sandwiches and sweets and other finger foods. And then that evening, we're doing a family movie night. Now, we're showing a movie called Pilgrim's Progress. And Pilgrim's Progress is the second best-selling book of all time, story of Christian and his journey of faith. And it is a cartoon, but I will say this. It's PG-rated, and so for parents with little ones, there are a few scenes they might find scary. You need to be prepared for that, and or just that might be a choice not to bring the littlest of the little ones to it, but that's up to you. You can make a good judgment for your children in that one. The other thing I want to mention is on August 12th, that's a Monday night at 7 p.m., we're going to be having a special business meeting. As many of you know, we've been for the last year or so, we planted a church in Alma called The Tide, working together in partnership with Riverside Albert. And we had told you at the time that it was an 18-month trial, so we're going to bring an update, and that's your opportunity to decide whether we want to continue supporting that effort. Because we said we would come back to you and give you the opportunity to speak into that and to make a decision about moving forward. So we're looking forward to that and also bringing you some updates as well. So that's August 12th at 7 p.m. Please mark that down. We want to see you there. And I believe that's all the announcements I need to cover this morning. I invite you to stand and let's open our service in prayer. Father, we are truly grateful to gather. And Lord, as we were just singing and talking about today we choose, Lord, I pray that would be our prayer every day, not just today. That each day of our lives, we would choose to give our lives to you again and again. We'd understand what Jesus meant when he said we were to take up our cross daily and follow him. That there's a cost to following Jesus, but that the reward is so great, the blessing is so great. And Lord, we pray that you'd help us to live in that perfect tension of serving and loving you and loving one another. And that, Father, in this time, you might encourage us in that journey of faith as we do it in community with one another and with you. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you greet one another?
All right, let's continue on with the service. 10,000 Reasons.
Who you are. Free are
Amen, amen. You say thanks to the worship team this morning? This time I'm going to invite our ushers for a morning offering. It's reflecting on Jesus' words about the value of the kingdom of heaven found in Matthew 13. He said, "The kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field, which a man found and covered up. Then in his joy he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field." Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant in search of fine pearls who, on finding one pearl of great value, went and sold all that he had, and he bought it. My friends, when we give our gifts on Sundays, we're recognizing the value of the kingdom of heaven, recognizing the value of what God has given to us, of who he is, of him being part of our lives. Let me encourage you this morning as you give, in the many ways that we have to give, that this is our opportunity to declare in a tangible way our love for our Lord and Savior and to show him our obedience and show him that we are faithful as he is faithful. Would you pray with me? Father, we thank you for the opportunity to give. We thank you, Lord, for your great gift of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. We pray, Lord, that we would see and understand the value of what we have been given, and we would consider no cost too high to gain what you have promised to us. We thank you, Lord, for this opportunity. We pray you'd bless each one who gives. In Jesus' name, amen.
You may be seated.
with me. This is my first time doing this. Come on, everybody. Is this bell coming? Whatever. Oh, my. Okay. Good to see all of you this morning. All right. Okay. Is anybody thankful for anything this morning? Anything awesome happened this week? William, are you going to help me out? Anything good happened to you this week? Want to thank God for? Nothing. Not sure. How about you? You always have something to say. Oh, they're not going to help me out this morning. Okay. You. Oh, my gosh. Okay, speak.
So I was asked back to camp this week to volunteer So I went to a serve camp and I was asked back to volunteer this week. And I'm actually really happy because they were looking for more male volunteers, and there was a chance I wouldn't be called back. So I'm really excited.
All right.
Because I went to camp this week.
Good, awesome. Thank God for that. All right. Do you want to thank God for something? Well, God knows. Okay, so we're going to stay in church this morning because we weren't sure how many kids we were going to have. So if anybody didn't get a board, they're at the back. You can meet me at the back after so I can give you one so you can draw in church or whatever. Okay, so let's pray, everybody. Okay, thank you, Jesus, for this day. Thank you for everything that you've done for us. Thank you, Lord, for every kid here. Thank you for every adult here. Thank you that we're all healthy enough to be here and to come and worship you and praise your name. And I pray that you bless the pastor as he delivers the word to us and open up our hearts and our minds and let us hear what the Spirit has to say to us. And bless everyone here and bless all the kids. And we thank you, Jesus, for everything. In your name, amen.
My brother-in-law was at the St. John Regional just over a year ago, awaiting his second open-heart surgery with infections so severe he was at death's door. My sister and I stayed there with him every day and into the evenings, praying often and especially before we left at night. The day of the surgery, I prayed and I prayed and I prayed. When we finally were able to see him, he looked right at me and he said, "I didn't think I'd make it through." To which I said, "I knew you would because we were praying." I found out later, his doctor didn't even expect him to make it. Prayer, it is a life-altering thing.
Amen. We need to hear more often how God is working in prayer. And in that light, we've asked some folks to do a series of short little videos like that. You're going to be hearing more of those week after week and be able to understand and know what God is doing, because he is doing miraculous things in our midst, and all too often we miss it. But let's come before the Lord in prayer this morning together. Let's pray. Father, we come to you this morning and we pray as David prayed. In Psalm 139, we read, "O Lord, you have searched me and you've known me. You know when I sit down and when I rise up. You discern my thoughts from afar. You search out my path and my lying down and are acquainted with all my ways. Even before a word is on my tongue, behold, O Lord, you know it altogether. You hem me in behind and before and lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is high. I cannot attain it. Where shall I go from your spirit? Or where shall I flee from your presence? If I ascend to heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in Sheol, you are there. If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, even there your hand shall lead me and your right hand shall hold me. If I say, surely the darkness shall cover me, and the light about me be night, even the darkness is not dark to you. The night is bright as the day, for darkness is as light with you. For you formed my inward parts. You knitted me together in my mother's womb. I praise you, for I'm fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works. My soul knows it very well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was being made in secret, intricately woven in the depths of the earth. Your eyes saw my unformed substance. In your book were written, every one of them, the days that were formed for me, when as yet there were none of them. How precious to me are your thoughts, O God. How vast is the sum of them. If I would count them, they are more than the sand. I awake and I am still with you. Oh, that you would slay the wicked, O God. O men of blood, depart from me. They speak against you with malicious intent. Your enemies take your name in vain. Do I not hate those who hate you, O Lord? And do I not loathe those who rise up against you? I hate them with complete hatred. I count them my enemies. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts. And see if there be any grievous way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting. Father, that is our prayer this morning. That you would search us, that you would know us, and Father, that you would show us if there are grievous ways within us. Lead us in your everlasting way. Allow us to know you more, to honor you, to give you glory, and to, Father, then pour out what you've shown us, what you've done in us, with one another as your body, the church, and into our community. That you've given us to serve, to love, and to reach with the good news about Jesus Christ. It's in his name we pray. Amen. Well, good morning once again, and good morning to those of our friends watching us at the Tide and online. We want to say welcome, and thanks for being with us, and good morning to Pastor Paul and Colleen. We're glad you're part of our team, and glad to hear that you're doing well, Paul. So this week, I somehow ran into some strange excuses. I don't know, has anybody here ever heard a strange excuse? You know, some of you that have taught have heard that old nugget, you know, the dog ate my homework. That's a strange excuse, isn't it? It's probably not usually true, but I ran into some more strange excuses this week, and it got me thinking about strange excuses. And so I went and did a little bit of digging, and Google can make you laugh when you let it. Strange excuses for ending relationships. Here's one of these are true, apparently. I have a high-maintenance bird that demands a lot of my attention, which makes my other pet jealous. So now I need to spend more time with my dog, so I don't have time for our relationship. Yeah. I know we discussed going paragliding in July, but if I were ever permanently injured in an accident, I don't think you'd stay with me, so I'm leaving you now before that happens. Yeah. And here's the deal. I just can't be with someone who likes Sharknado. And in case you don't know what that is, that's a movie about sharks dropped out of the sky by a tornado. Okay, Sharknado, yeah. I've never seen it, but I heard about it. And then I ran across strange excuses for not coming to work, and some of these are a little bit simpler, but here's one. A refrigerator fell on me. A deer bit me during hunting season. And my personal favorite, I thought I won the lottery, but I was wrong. Yeah, okay. Strange excuse for not coming to work, yeah. You know what's interesting is the Bible actually contains some stories of people who had strange excuses for sin, of all things. You know, and that may sound weird, but there it is. It's actually true. The excuse goes like this. God is so faithful, and he is so holy, and he's righteous, and I know I'm not. So what I figured was I would sin more, and I'd be more unfaithful so that people would realize, compared to me, how faithful God is. Makes perfect sense, doesn't it? You know? I'm going to sin more because it feels so good to be forgiven. I want to show how gracious God is, so I'm going to mess up more often on purpose so that people realize how gracious God is. Does that sound like a strange excuse for sin, for bad behavior? And yet, nevertheless, this is actually contained in Scripture. I mean, if you would go read Paul and what he writes to the Corinthians, you find out that they had some of these confusing ideas and excuses. But today we're working through Romans still, and I want you to turn with me to Romans chapter 3. And we're going to look at this because Paul wants to just briefly wrestle with two questions. The first one is kind of a strange question. He says, is there any value in being a Jew? Which he is a Jew, and Jesus was a Jew, so you would think that was an obvious question, but he wants to wrestle with that for just a moment. And then he asks that question, is there any value to sin? Which is just such a strange question to ask, if you really think about it. Does our sin have value? Strange question, isn't it? But let's dive in Romans chapter 3, and starting at verse 1, and take a look at these two questions, because I think there's something that relates to us in our lives and world today. He starts very simply in verse 1 and 2 saying, then what advantage has the Jew, or what is the value of circumcision? Now remember, we've been talking through Romans chapter 1 and Romans chapter 2 about God's judgment and how it works. And in Romans 2, he very specifically was addressing the Jewish people who had this tendency to look down their noses at those of us who didn't have the law of God, and the Gentiles they're called in the Bible. And when the Jewish people would look down their noses, they'd go, yes, well, I'm a descendant of Abraham, and I was circumcised on the eighth day, and I've been given a special name, and because I have DNA from Abraham, I'm good with God, I'm one of his chosen people. And Paul had quickly disabused them of the notion that you could claim to be a child of Abraham if you didn't actually obey the law of Abraham, and that you could get away with disobedience and still be blessed. Paul says, no, that doesn't work. And then he says this, then what advantage is there in being a Jew? Because he just finished saying, there's no advantage if you don't live faithfully as a Jew. Just like there's an advantage to the Gentile that lives faithfully when they don't have the law. And he says, what advantage has it? What value? What is the value of circumcision? He goes on to say, much in every way, to begin with, the Jews were entrusted with the oracles of God. That's a strange word, oracle, isn't it? We don't use that very much these days. But what you'll find out if you read different translations is that this comes out this way. In the New Living Translation, it says they've been entrusted with the whole revelation of God. Or if you looked at the NIV, it says with the very words of God. So what Paul's talking about here, very clearly the Roman Church, is this, the Bible, specifically for the Jews, the Old Testament. Saying, what value is there in being a Jew? Well, you folks are the lucky ones. You're the chosen people of God, and he gave you his word so you'd know what he expects. Wouldn't that be nice these days? So often people say, well, what does God expect from me? What does God want from me? What is, you know, if there is a God, you know, what place does he have in my life? Well, the Jewish people were entrusted with that information as a nation. Their job was to display that to the world. Now, they were entrusted with the word for a few different reasons. One, to preserve it, obviously. Because if somebody doesn't copy it out again, eventually the copy that you're using gets worn out. Anybody here ever replaced their Bible? I wish you'd all raise your hands. Because that means you've worn it out, okay? But the point is, in the days before the printing press, somebody had to handwrite the Bible. Think about that for a second. And the Jewish people were entrusted with that responsibility over the generation after generation. When a scroll would start to get worn, they would copy out a brand new one and make sure that it was passed on. So they were entrusted with that. That's important because it's the Word of God. And we want to know what God has for us, who he is, what he's done, and what he would have us to do, right? They were entrusted with it. But they weren't just entrusted with it so they could preserve it. Because we have historians and archaeologists and museum curators and those kind of people that preserve stuff today. And the fact that they preserve something in and of itself has value, but it's not the most important thing, is it? We want to see that information then also transmitted, passed on, don't we? If information is useful, it should be transmitted. And we take transmission of information for granted today. We live in the information age. But nevertheless, it was value because they were entrusted with the preservation and the transmission of God's word. Now, it's not just God's word that they were entrusted to transmit, of course. God chose his people so that when people in the rest of the world looked at the Jewish nation, they would go, wow, there's something special about their God. There's something different about their God. In fact, their God is greater than any other God that we believe in. And therefore, he must be the Almighty One. And they would learn things about God because they were entrusted to preserve it. And Paul says, if you were entrusted to do this, what good is it if you're not faithful to it and you don't obey it? That's what he just finished telling us about in chapter 2. If you have the word of God, if you know what God has for you, if you say, I've heard it, but you don't do it, there's no value, is there? And so he wants to be very clear that for the Jewish people, there's great value in being a Jew because you've been entrusted with something, but that entrusting implies that you do something with what you're entrusted with. Now, he goes on to say, what if some were unfaithful? You've been entrusted with something. What if some of those Jewish people were unfaithful? Does their faithlessness nullify the faithfulness of God? It's not a trick question, is it? No matter what the Jewish people did, God remained faithful. So we could say, by no means, which is what Paul says, verse 4, by no means. Let God be true, though everyone were a liar, as it is written, that you may be just justified in your words and prevail when you are judged. I'm sorry, total aside, you know what I love about kids? Is when I think about Jesus teaching the Sermon on the Mount, when I think about him feeding the 5,000, this is what Jesus had, except picture 5,000 people, how many kids were running around. And it's so wonderful that we're good with that. It really is that we're glad that kids are here, isn't it? Yeah? Yeah. Because I remember being a parent with little ones, and I remember being a little bit embarrassed if my kids didn't do what I thought they were supposed to do. You know what? I don't care. If we can't focus enough on God Almighty when a child's running around, the problem's us, not the kid. Amen? Listen, our faithlessness does not make God unfaithful. And the fact that everyone lies doesn't mean God's not telling the truth. Just like when the world tries to say, well, I don't believe in God, I don't believe in Jesus, and I just want to go, wow, so if I don't believe in the prime minister, does that make him not the prime minister? Like, really? If I don't believe in the president of the United States, does that mean he's not the president? I mean, some of you going, I wish it worked that way, but it doesn't, does it? You know? And when we talk about God, when we talk about Jesus, when we talk about God's word, the fact that somebody says, I don't believe it, somehow that scares us, and it shouldn't, because not believing something doesn't make it not true, amen? I mean, we're fortunate, because there's lots of things that we should believe or should do from God's word that we don't, either because we don't know it or because we chose not to, just like these Jewish people. They were entrusted with something powerful. And Paul just wants to say, listen, there is value in being a Jew. You've been entrusted with something precious, something valuable. Just like I read from Matthew there, but the treasure hidden in the field, the kingdom of heaven is like a treasure hidden in the field. It's worth everything we have to go and get it, to buy that field, whatever it takes. You know, people nowadays, they want to go buy a house. They fall in love with a property or with a home, and they think, I don't care what it costs me. I'll be house poor, but I just have to have that, right? And we think that that's so important. But the kingdom of heaven is so much greater, so much more valuable. And when we are entrusted with something so precious, what are we doing with it? Paul wants to say that the Jewish people, there's great value there. And when he is talking here in chapter, verse 3 and 4, he's actually quoting from David, who wrote in Psalm 51, the Psalm of Penitence. Some of you remember the story. David's been confronted by the prophet Nathan about his adultery. He's been with another man's wife, Bathsheba, and he's arranged for Bathsheba's husband, Uriah, to be killed. And he's confronted with the truth of what he's done. It's now visible. The king is on trial, as it were. And then Nathan says, you're the one. We know what you did. God knows what you did. And David cries out. In Psalm 51, verse 4, he says these words, against you, you only have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight, so that you may be justified in your words and blameless in your judgment. This verse has always bothered me. Does it bother anybody else? So David doesn't go to war at the time when the kings go to war. He doesn't do what he's supposed to do. He's already not obeyed God, because if that's the job of the king, to go to war and lead his people, then he should be at the battlefront, shouldn't he? So he's already in a little bit of trouble. Then he's wandering around looking at other people's rooftops, which you're not supposed to do. He sees a woman that's not his. He doesn't say, gee, she's somebody else's, I shouldn't look. He looks, and then he sends for her. She's brought to him. He sleeps with her. Gets her pregnant, by the way. And then he tries to trick her husband into sleeping with her so he'll think it's his kid. And then when that doesn't work, he sends the husband back to war and tells his general to make sure that the man doesn't come home again. And then we read Psalm 51, verse 4, and David says, against you only have I sinned, talking to God. And I go, wait a second, there's a few other people that got sinned again, amen? Sinned against. I mean, he sinned against Bathsheba, didn't he? He sinned against his army by not being there for them. He sinned against Uriah for sure. He made sure the guy ended up dead. And in the context of what Paul is writing to the Roman church, let God be true, though everyone were a liar, that you may be justified in your words and prevail when you're a judge. Paul's driving at a very important truth that we miss so often. The Bible says that if we are to obey the law in the New Testament sense of the word, that we have to love God and love our neighbor as ourselves. Right? And we think, okay, that makes it easy for me. But what we fail to understand is that when we don't love God and when we don't love neighbor and when we don't love ourselves, when we sin against God or against our neighbor or against ourselves, all those sins are ultimately against God. See, we get so focused on, well, I said something I shouldn't say to my wife, so I got to go apologize to her. And I do. But when's the last time you sinned against somebody else and you went and very humbly begged forgiveness, hopefully humbly, that you thought, I also need to confess this to God? I recognize that if I sin against my wife, I've sinned against the one who gave her to me. Amen? Or when you confessed, oh Lord, I did that thing I shouldn't do again, and Lord, please cleanse me, please heal me and everything else. Do we recognize when we sinned against our own body, again, we're still sinning against the Lord? That's what David's trying to drive at, or Paul's driving at as well, is that we have to deal with what we've done. All of our sin is ultimately against God. There's value in being a Jew, but everything that they did in disobedience was against the Father in heaven. And it's in that context that he then asks this question, does our sin have value? Because this is what people are actually arguing. It's a strange excuse. I'm going, well, if that's the case, if all our sin's against God, and if it's such a mess anyway, then at least my blackness shows his light. Look at verse 5. He says, but if our unrighteousness serves to show the righteousness of God, what shall we say? That God is unrighteous to inflict wrath on us? I speak in a human way, Paul says. He's saying, should we say that God's unfair for punishing us for doing something that makes him look good? Do you see the contrast? Let me illustrate if I can. I've used this illustration before in other contexts. If I were to have a little candle on a stand up here, and it was the only light in the room, and we're all sitting here with this single candle, you'd really notice that one light, wouldn't you? But what's more is, we would all have a very vague shadow on the back wall from that one candle, wouldn't we? Wouldn't be very dark at all, right? But what's interesting is, the closer you get to the candle, the darker and clearer the shadow gets. With me? And this is what the people were trying to suggest in this day. If we can't make God, be faithful, if we can't obey God and do what we're supposed to do, we may as well get close to the candle so at least the shadow's dark, so they go, wow, that's darkness, that's light, I can see the difference now. It's crazy when you think about it, isn't it? But that's what they were wrestling with. If our unrighteousness serves to show the righteousness of God, serves to show how light he is compared to us, how dark we are, then God must be unfair to punish us for that, isn't he? Because we make him look good. Once again, Paul in verse 6, by no means. For then how could God judge the world? If he was being unfair, he couldn't judge us, could he? He couldn't bring his judgment. He says, but he's still arguing about this. He says, but wait, you say that, you say no, by no means, but if through my lie God's truth abounds to his glory, he's getting glory, why am I still being condemned as a sinner? And why not do evil that good may come, as some people slanderously charge us with saying? Isn't it interesting? Paul has just finished saying in Romans 2 that on that day God judges the secrets of men by Christ Jesus. And Jesus himself in John 8:26 had said, I have much to say about you and much to judge, but he who sent me is true, and I declare to the world what I've heard from him. See, this problem of judgment And what we do is that we want to say God isn't really good. I mean, that's one of the things you hear most often in the world is people saying, if God was really good, if God really loved us, and fill in the blank, right? Somehow we want to think that the bad things we did are beneficial. We're going to take Romans 8:28 out of context. It says, all things work for good for those that love him and are called according to his purpose. So even my bad stuff must be good, right? No. It's not how it works. But we've twisted things in this world, and we call things beneficial that aren't. Paul finished telling us that in Romans 1, right? That bad people call bad things good and good things bad. For example, Debbie and I, a few years back, we went on a trip down to Washington, and while we were down there, we went on one of these cave expeditions in a place on the way. And in this cave, they had these pools of water, and in those pools of water, there were fish, which was strange. I didn't expect to find fish living in a cave. But they have something called a beneficial mutation because the cave is so dark. They turned out the lights at one point. You can do this all day long and you can't see your hand in front of your face. It's so dark. I've never been anyplace so dark in my life. Even a power outage in Albert County is not that dark. Okay, just saying. But these fish that have lived in this cave for generation after generation after generation now have a so-called beneficial mutation in that many of them can no longer see or don't even have eyes. Now think about that. They've been in the dark so long that they can't see anymore. And they call this a beneficial mutation. Now, I thought beneficial meant good for me, didn't you? And what's Paul saying here? People have this strange excuse. They're trying to say, well, at least my sin has a benefit. It makes God look good in comparison. I got news for you, folks. He doesn't need our help to look good, to be righteous, to be holy, to be true, to be faithful. We don't need to make him look better by being more unfaithful. Paul's trying to communicate this as clearly as he can because God's judgment is ultimately fair. If you were to glance at Romans 6, he said, what shall we say then? Are we to continue in sin that grace may abound? By no means. In verse 15 in chapter 6, what then? Are we to sin because we are not under law but under grace? There's our question for us, isn't it? We're not under the law, we're under grace. Again, by no means. Grace should trigger works of righteousness. Far from the opposite, which is where we often live. I mean, Jesus was the one who said in John chapter 8, he said this to the Jews, again, the audience that Paul's trying to talk to right now and about, says, if you abide in my word, you are truly my disciples and you will know the truth and the truth will set you free, not leave you in bondage. If God's truth leaves you in bondage, then it's not true. But God's truth doesn't do that. It sets us free. God's goodness may be more visible when I do evil, but that doesn't make them good. So let's go back to Paul's two questions. Is there any value in being a Jew? And a stranger question, does our sin have value? Well, let's consider if we apply what Paul's saying to ourselves. The Jews were entrusted with the word of God. What have we been entrusted with? That same word. That same word. With the same responsibility to preserve it, to transmit it, and to be faithful and obey it. In the same way, their sin leads to judgment, even though it makes God look good, so does ours. It leads to judgment. But what's scary for me to think about, and it should be for you as well, is that the Jews were tempted to rationalize their actions as being, at least there's some benefit. At least we make God look good. We can point to the Jewish story of failure after failure after failure in their nation's history and in individuals that afterwards God showed his faithfulness by taking them back again. But that doesn't make it good. The ends never justify the means. But here's what really bothers me. Here's what really bothers me. See, we could talk about, and we may be already thinking about all the ways we don't measure up. And as soon as we use the word judgment, As soon as I preach on judgment, I get feeling convicted and judged and start thinking about the things I'm not doing. And maybe as soon as you hear the word, you start thinking about the things you're not doing. I could focus there, but that's not where I want to focus this morning, because that's not what's really bothering me. I'm not interested in making a guilt trip on anybody. I'm not interested in trying to overwhelm you. I just want to think about this for a second. We are so blessed as Canadians. We really are. And what I'm really concerned about now more than ever is that we are missing out on something. And we don't even realize. And that is, we're missing out on the true blessings that God promised. We think we're blessed because of our material blessings, because all the freedom we have and all the stuff we're able to have and the way we're able to speak our mind and all these other things. We think that's the blessing from God. But the blessings he has for us and the rewards he has for us aren't the things we think they are. Now, let me be clear. I'm not talking about salvation. Salvation is found in grace alone, by faith alone, in Christ alone. For those who have not yet received Christ, put your faith in him, and he will save you from your sins. His death and resurrection were absolutely sufficient to pay for anything you've ever done or will do. But let me be clear. Our blessings in this life and our rewards in the next are dependent on what we do with what we've been given. I sang that great song just before I preached. The breath in our lungs is from him. My friends, we've been given everything we have. See, what the issue, I think, is that God will still be righteous. And God will still be good. And God will still build his church if we don't do what we're supposed to do. That's probably good news. But we will miss out on the blessings he has for us in this life and on the rewards he has for us in the next if we don't do what he's given us to do. And the irony is, many people in this life live with FOMO. Some of you have heard this term, right? FOMO, fear of missing out, right? We're so worried about missing out on the latest episode or on the latest opportunity or going to visit this or that place or country or person or thing. We're so afraid of missing out. And the irony is we should have horrific FOMO, horrific fear of missing out on God's blessings and God's rewards. That should drive us every single day. Every moment when you wake up, your first thought would be, God, how do I just engage with you? God, I want all the blessing you have for me. I want to earn every reward I can so that when I meet you face to face, I hear those amazing words, well done, good and faithful servant. And what scares me is we are so content, so complacent, so lukewarm today because we think we're blessed already. We're not that hungry. You go to other places in the world and they are desperate for God's blessing because they know what it is to want to, when they pray the prayer, give us this day our daily bread, to truly have to wait that day for it to come instead of going to the freezer and taking out another loaf. We need to develop a fear of missing out on God's blessings. And God's blessings in this life come in a couple of key ways, my friends. It's really fairly simple. It comes in, I want to argue, two key ways. There may be others, but these ones are really critical. If we want to be blessed by God, the first way we are blessed by God is when we give. And I'm talking about your wallet. I'm talking about financially. I mean, just go back and read Malachi 3, verse 10, when it says, bring the full tithe into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house. And thereby, this is what God says, thereby put me to the test, says the Lord of hosts. If I will not open the windows of heaven for you and pour down for you a blessing until there is no more need. Some of you are saying, well, but Jeff, you're talking about the law again. I say, hang on a second, let's back up. Giving to God started with the first two kids that were born on the planet. Cain and Abel each brought an offering to God before there was a law, my friends. And Abel was commended because he brought the first fruits to God. We see it throughout the scripture before the law was given. We see when Noah and his family, when they got off the ark, the first thing Noah did was make a sacrifice, an offering to God. We see Abraham, long before the law, giving a sacrifice, tithe, 10% of what he'd gotten in a battle to Melchizedek. Over and over again, the principle of giving is there. Jesus taught in giving. Paul taught in giving. And there's more than 2,000 references to money and possessions in the Bible. And yet we miss this simple truth. If you want God's blessing, God blesses those who give generously and who are obedient to him when they give joyfully and cheerfully through the church, the body of Christ. This one's crystal clear. You're missing out when you don't tithe and give offerings to God. And I'm scared. Many people are missing out today. In North America, the number of people who are going to church and call themselves committed Christians that tithe is 1.7%. I don't say that to condemn anybody, but rather to say that means 92.3% of Christians are missing out on part of God's blessing. Think about that. Sorry, 98. I can get this math right. 98, not 92. The second place we're missing out on blessings from God is when you don't serve. Paul in Galatians 5 said, "You, my brothers and sisters, were called to be free. But do not use your freedom to indulge the sinful nature. Rather, serve one another in love." I think we like the American freedom, which is I get to do whatever I want, whenever I want, with whoever I want, however I want, as long as I don't hurt nobody. But we weren't given freedom so we could do whatever we want. We were given freedom so that we could choose to serve one another. Jesus said it this way in Mark chapter 8, "For whoever would save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake and the gospel's will save it." You know, we're so concerned about, well, you know, I'm so busy, I don't think I have time. Whoever gives his life for the gospel will save it. I'm not saying you should never be home, okay? I'm not suggesting to go back to those old days of if the doors of the church were open, you had to be there. But I am saying we're supposed to do life together and serve one another. And love one another in tangible and real ways. Our motivation is love for God, knowing that God will bless when we give and serve. And Jesus says that anyone who does something for their brother or sister has done it for him. That's what Matthew 25 tells us in the sheep and the goats. It says, if you went and fed somebody, if you gave them clothing, if you gave them something to drink, you did it for me, Jesus says. If you didn't, you didn't do it for me. I'm afraid you're missing out. I'm afraid we are missing out because we don't get that blessings in this love life come when we serve and give on an intentional, consistent basis. And there's people that go, oh, well, you know, I did my time. Listen, your time for a certain thing may come to an end, but your date and time for giving and serving never come to an end until the day you face Jesus. And even then, the scriptures say, if you used your talents well here, he's got more for you there. I don't know what it is, but I'm excited about that. Sometimes it's the least of these too, isn't it? I had a great story a number of years ago. I read in a novel. Man arrives in heaven was how the story went, and he was being given the grand tour. And he was shown the streets of gold and the pearly gates and all those wonderful pictures in Scripture. But then he was going by a large stadium. Do you know the stadiums in heaven? I'm sorry to say this to my wife, there's probably no football, but there are stadiums in heaven. Just kidding, honey. I don't know if there's football or not. She says there is. But the man in the story is going by this large stadium, and when he looks through the doorways, he sees the stadium's just packed, people shoulder to shoulder, spellbound by the speaker on stage. And when they look at the speaker on stage, it's a man with Down's syndrome. Just think about that for a second, that picture. He's going to use the foolish to put the wise to shame, the weak to put the strong to shame. And while we're busy saying, well, I don't know anything, therefore I'm foolish, or I can't do anything, I'm too weak, that's what God loves to use, my friend. So don't tell me you don't know enough, and don't tell me you're not strong enough. Give what you've got, and God will take it like loaves and fishes and feed many. This is where the blessing is found. But what's amazing is we don't only get blessed in this life. I want you to be afraid of missing out on the blessing in this life, but even more afraid of missing out on the rewards in the next life. There's incredible rewards promised to us. And we don't talk about this often enough. I've realized that God's word promises actual crowns for those who are faithful and live our lives for him. He says there's a crown called the crown of life for those who persevere under trials. You're saying, I'm having a really hard time at work. They're giving me a hard time because I believe in Jesus and they want to make me work Sundays and they're threatening to take my job away. Listen, there's a crown for being faithful. There's an incorruptible crown for those who practice self-denial. That's not a cultural norm, is it? If I want it, I should have it, is our culture. But for those who practice self-denial, who say no to what they want in favor of what God wants, and who persevere in it, there's a crown. For there's a crown of righteousness for just for those who pursue intimacy with God, who just every day say, God, I want to be close to you. There's a crown just for wanting to be close to God and pursuing it. Think about it. For those that say, I don't know if it's worth it reading my Bible and spending time in prayer by myself. Listen, you're earning a crown. There's a crown of glory for those who shepherd the flock in unselfish love and are a good example. And it would be so easy for me to read that and go, yay, I get to do that one because I'm a shepherd. But listen, every one of you can shepherd somebody. Every one of you can be a discipler and teach somebody else more about Jesus. Every one of you can find a place to be a shepherd. There's a crown of rejoicing. That's for all those who practice evangelism, which is just sharing the good news about Jesus with other people. There's blessings and rewards for all those who are faithful with what God entrusted them, the oracles of God, the word of God. Now, maybe some of you are saying, I don't know where to start. How do I earn these blessings, Jeff? How do I have greater blessings? How do I earn greater rewards? Well, the obvious answer is start with your money. Start with giving. There's many ways to give. And I just challenge you to consider that God promised that you could test him in this, and he promised that he would be faithful in meeting your needs if you did. Now, I want to be careful with those words there because it's needs, not wants. If you give God $100, he's not giving you a motorcycle, guys. Sorry. But there are sometimes material blessings as well. I encourage you, if you've never done it, if you've never chosen to just take that big step and say, well, I could never do that, Jeff, try it for 3 months. Do it. Go ahead and do a 3-month trial. Go ahead and test God in this. I dare you. And you will discover, as I have and some others have here, he is so faithful. When you trust him with your money, you never have to worry about money. And secondly, you can step up and serve. I mean, there's needs all around us right here within God's church. And you can and should be using the gifts and skills God has given you to serve your church in order to be blessed and receive a reward. And you may say, Jeff, there's nothing I can do. You don't understand, Jeff. Either I'm too busy or you don't understand how tired I am. My job's really hard or I've got difficulties in my family or maybe you got some other reason or excuse. There's all kinds of excuses. You know what? I just want to tell you about Carolyn for a second. Carolyn was such a sweetheart in my last church. She came to me one day with exactly that statement. She says, Jeff, I can't do anything. She says, I'm old, I'm tired, I'm weak. There's really nothing much I can do, but I really felt like I needed to do something. So Jeff, I'm here today to ask you, is there anything you have to do every week that you hate that I could do for you? That's what she said to me. Is there anything you have to do every week that you hate that I could do for you? Do you know what a dream that was? I was like, nobody's ever asked me that question before. They're always, I hate this, you do it, right? Nobody ever offers to take something I hate off my plate. How about you? Anybody else get asked that question ever? Wouldn't it be wonderful if somebody said, something you hate, I could do for you? Husbands, wives, what if you said that to each other? Listen, here's a marriage challenge for you. What if every couple were to say to their spouse, tell me one thing you hate, and I'll do that for you. And we did that for each other. What would that do for our marriages? Imagine that, just serving one another. And oh yeah, you'd be blessed. And oh yeah, you'd be earning a crown because you can actually get away with this in your own family. God notices when you care about each other. Isn't that wonderful? Listen, Carolyn, she had this question to me and I said, you know what, Carolyn? I hate folding bulletins. I got so much on my plate already, and every week these stupid bulletins, they're sitting on the copier waiting for me to fold them. It's always last minute. It's always something I have to do after everything else gets done, and usually when I'm tired and irritable already and just want to go to bed. And she says, well, I'll fold the bulletins for you. Now, I've had other people say they'd volunteer. That's wonderful. But you know what? Carolyn, she knew she was serving God. And she kept focused on the reward. Because you know what? It didn't matter to her what day the bulletins were done. She came in one day on a Wednesday, I think it was, and she said, oh, the bulletins aren't done? I said, no, I'm sorry. We didn't get them done today. Something came up. And you know what I've had happen to me many, many times is the volunteer in that position would go, well, I'm not doing this anymore. Or at least give me some attitude. I know none of you have ever done that to somebody, but that's what I've had happen. Other places. Other places, yeah. Carolyn would say, no problem, I'll come back tomorrow. And as it happened, I think a funeral came up. I didn't get them done the next day. She came in. She said, no problem. She came in on Saturday night. She didn't care what day they got done. I told her, I normally try and have them done on this day. But she decided, for 6 years, she folded bulletins. And never once did she complain about what day they were done. But you know what she did every time? She did it 52 weeks a year for 6 years and made sure after they were folded, they got where they needed to be. So I never had to think about that either. Anybody can do something. And if everybody does something, the body works. The blessing is given and the reward is earned. This is how God promised it would work. And see, there's always room for more people helping. Some of you are going, well, I don't know what to do. It's okay. We can help you find something to do. Because I'll just give you a quick list, okay? We could use help with visiting, with prayer, with benevolence, with worship, with tech, with children's ministry, with youth ministry, with mom's ministry, with men's ministry, couples ministry, singles ministry, celebrate recovery, north of 55, missions work, administrative work, facilities care maintenance, vision and future planning, evangelism, discipleship, small groups, and I bet you there's a few more. Bulletins. Thank you, Peggy. Amen. Listen, there's always room for help. The only question that you need to ask if you want to be blessed and earn a reward, a crown, is what gifts have I been given? And go get to using them. That's all you need to do. If you want to get together and serve someone else, I promise you'll be blessed. And I promise you will earn a reward. Because God is faithful and the reward is great. I mean, we got a practical place to start right here on the stage, this Backpack Sunday. I mean, so easy. Wander in the store, buy a backpack or get some paper or look for what's needed on that list out there and say, I can get that and put your name on the page. You can come help sort and load backpacks. You can be there to help give them up. You can make a meal for the day so that when people are coming, they are blessed. You can give $35 to help some poor parent cover their school fees for their kid. I mean, there's so many ways. It's so easy. And you know what? One of my dreams now is that you would so fear missing out on God's prayer blessings and so fear missing out on earning a reward that never again would I have somebody say to me, well, nobody asked me. You've been asked by God Almighty to use what He gave you for His glory and to build up the body of the church. Okay? And the problem with you waiting to be asked is you're assuming that somebody else knows what you can do. And you know what? We probably don't. There's all kinds of hidden talents right in our midst. Maybe I'm wrong, but I would suspect there's somebody here that knows how to scuba dive. I don't know how we use that for the kingdom, but I bet you we can find a way. I would bet there's somebody here that's gone skydiving. I don't know how to use that for God's glory, but I bet you we could find a way. I bet you there's some people here that know how to cross stitch. I bet you we could use that for God's glory. I bet you there's somebody here who knows how to change oil in a car. We could use that for God's glory, eh? There's some people here who love playing board games. I bet you we could use that for God's glory. Whatever your particular gifts, inclination, passion, skills, talents, God wants to use them, and He wants to bless you for using them, and He wants to give you a reward for using them. And my prayer today is that instead of being entrusted with something and justifying what you do by going, well, at least God looks good in comparison to me, that you would instead be afraid of missing out on all that our Father in heaven has for us. both a blessing in this life and a reward in the next. And that you would actively seek out ways and opportunities to use them. I promise you, you're never going to come talk to me and say, Jeff, I want to, and find me saying, no way, you're not allowed. I'm going to be going, okay, how do we figure out how to get that done? Or where can we engage that gift or ability? If you're saying, I don't know where to serve, Jeff, but I could do this. Well, listen, we'll help you find a place. That's what the church does. We help each other figure out what our part is in the body. And then we empower you to go do that. Because you know what? I'm pretty sure of this. I've started woodworking. I've got a wood shop in my garage now, and I've still got all 10 digits. That's a good sign, right? And I got a table saw and a chop saw and a band saw. I got all kinds of ways to take fingers off. So far, so good. But my point is, if I took a finger off, it's not much good anymore, right? And worse yet, if I lose a finger, the whole body's impacted. But when everything's there, the body can accomplish amazing things. And I'm most afraid that we're going to miss out on that. What it looks like for the church to be the body of Christ, each part doing its part for his glory, to reach this community with the good news we've been entrusted with. Amen? So let's pursue his blessing, his true blessing, and the reward we're promised, and be more afraid of missing out on that than anything else. Let's pray together. Father, today we pray that you will give us courage and patience so that when we face trials of many kinds, we can earn that crown of life you promised. Today we pray that you would show us how to practice self-denial. Lord, teach us what we should give up in favor of what you've offered so we can earn an incorruptible crown. Father, create a deep desire for you in our hearts that we might earn that wonderful crown of righteousness. Father, show us where we could serve, where we could shepherd someone or some small group or larger group, Lord, so that we could earn, Father, the crown of glory. And Father, give us opportunities, we pray. Help us to see the ones that are all around us, to share the good news about Jesus, to share our faith in Jesus, to encourage others to put their faith in him, Father, so we could earn the crown of rejoicing. Lord, most of all, so we could earn your approval on that day. On that day when every tear will be wiped away, on that day when the judgment comes, Lord, what we long to hear is, well done, good and faithful servant. Lord, help us to have fear of missing out on that day, of sitting back and going, I made it, and that's all. But instead, to be excited about receiving our reward, the rewards that you promised. Thank you, Father, for that incredible incentive to pursue you, to seek you, to do all that we can do in response to the gift that did everything we would ever need, our salvation purchased by Christ. We pray in his name. Amen.
Thank you, Jeff. Please stand with me one last time today. Mountains bow down and the seas will roar.
may be seated. As we come to this table, it is our custom to collect a special offering for the needs of those in this community around us. We call this the benevolent offering. And we use these gifts with a team of people who are called and equipped to practice both confidentiality and discretion and discernment to make sure that those we help genuinely have need, but also hear the good news about Jesus as we help them, that this is God's hands reaching, helping, touching, ministering. And so we're going to invite the deacons and the helpers at this time. And if you would prepare, let's bow and ask God's blessing on this gift. Father, we do thank you for the privilege of giving to those in need. And Lord, we know that whatever we give, you will take and multiply. Thank you for the heart of each one. We pray again your blessing as they give. We pray, Father, as well that those that are given to, that are helped, would not only be blessed and encouraged, but would discover and discern the truth that you are God, that you are faithful, and that Jesus is the true Savior. Lord, I pray that as we go as ambassadors in this way, that each part of what we do would be multiplied and the blessings we receive would be based on how many lives we are able to touch through these gifts. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. In 1 Corinthians 11, we read, "For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way also, he took the cup after saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me.' For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." We come to this table to recognize that Jesus died for us, that his body on the cross, his blood shed, was enough to pay for our sins. The Bible says the wages of sin is death. And so Jesus died for us in our place, that all who believe in him would never die. So we come and we remember the body and blood of Christ, and we invite you to partake if you put your faith in Jesus Christ today, to remember what he did. These symbols, as we take them, the symbol of the bread and the cup, are just that, meant to remind us. And as Paul says, to proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. I'm going to ask Tyler to give thanks for the body of Christ this morning.
Lord, I want to thank you for the opportunity to come here this morning to share our time together. I want to thank you, Lord, for the gift that you have given us in your broken body. I want to thank you, Lord, also that body didn't stay broken, that you rose again, Lord, for the forgiveness of our sins. I thank you, Lord, every day for the gifts that you have given us. In Christ's name, amen.
The body of Christ, given for you. Take and eat in remembrance of him. In the same way, after the supper, he took that cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood poured out for you." We'll ask Carrie to give thanks for the cup of Christ.
Let's pray. Oh, Lord, we just thank you for your mercies. We praise you, oh God, for what you have done on the cross, your shed blood, your broken body. We give you thanks. We thank you. Thank you, oh God. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you.
Jesus' blood shed for you. Take and drink in remembrance of him. And after the supper, they sang a song and went out. So let's do the same, if you would stand together. Go as those entrusted with the good news about Jesus Christ. Go as those who have been promised blessings and rewards. Go in the power of Jesus. Go in the finished work of Jesus, knowing that the Spirit of God goes with you now and forevermore. Amen.